Good? All right. You got it on?
Yes.
You sure you push the button?
Yes. Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Glad to see everybody out this morning. What a day God's made. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and let's worship today. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for just giving us the opportunity to be here today and to lift our voices up in praise to you. Father, just bless us. Let your spirit move through this place as we worship you in spirit. All this in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Never failing, when mercy
Father, thank you again for another day of life that you've given us, and for this time when we can gather as a body again and to lift your Son Jesus Christ up above all others. We thank you for this group of believers that have gathered. We thank you for your faithfulness in you. Father, we thank you for the many blessings during this time of trials and tribulations. Please continue to lead us and lead our leaders and lead those who are just suffering at this time, that are looking for answers, and know that you are the answer. So please help us lead all to those answers and those decisions. First, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Sunday. Just like we've always done it, we're in Family Life Center and the kids will be down here below here. That's going to start next Sunday, 9 o'clock, just like it has always been. There will not be any connections after that is over, but at 10:30, weather permitting, we are going to be going down to the shelter next Sunday to have worship service down at the shelter. And if everything goes well, down there, that may be something that we do on a more continuous basis, because that gives us a lot more room to spread out. And but we're going to be sending a letter out this week. I'll be putting some stuff on the Facebook page too. You will get either one or the other. But basically, the way we're telling you is, if you want to back your truck up to the shelter and sit in the back of your truck and worship that way, that'll be fine. We are going to have the picnic tables down there set up, but we would encourage you to bring your own. A lot of people have those camping chairs. Is that what you call them?
Chairs.
What? Camping chairs?
Camping chairs.
Yeah. Anything, lawn chairs, whatever that you want to bring that might be more comfortable for you, go ahead and bring those, and hopefully it'll be a good time of worship next Sunday. So both of those things are happening next Sunday. We also have on Friday night, July the 3rd, Red, White, and Barbecue down at the shelter from 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock. We're going to have somebody providing the barbecue, and then we're asking everybody to bring side dishes and or desserts to contribute to the meal. There is a sign-up sheet out at the Welcome Center that we would ask you, if you're planning to come, just sign up and indicate how many people are going to be coming. We're going to have that. We're going to have a pretty good fireworks show that night. If you would like to make a contribution to the fireworks, that would be very appreciated. We're going to do that. And we're also going to have an Easter egg hunt down at the shelter for the Red, White, and Barbecue, because we miss it. So G-Dog and friends can come down and have the Easter egg hunt. It's going to be a good time. We'll have some different games and activities going on down there. It's possible that we'll have a petting zoo. Jonah's nodding his head yes. So we'll have a petting zoo, Gordon, for you to come down there and pet the animals. And that'd be exciting for you. But that's also gonna be going on. So a lot of different things going on. It's exciting to kind of sort of get back into the groove as best as we possibly can. So we hope that you'll be able to take part in that. Jonah also has an announcement that he would like to make.
For anybody who's taken part of the Church League Volleyball League at Grassy Creek throughout the summer, they're starting it back up July 7th, and it'll run through August 28th, and then there'll be an end-of-the-season tournament in September. And if anybody's interested in it, just come talk to me or message me on Facebook.
And that's co-ed, Dave and Sandy, if you both want to play. That'd be good. So,
I'm smiling.
Are you really? Frank and Elizabeth Morris's son Ted, age 18, was home from college for Christmas break. He had gotten a job to make a little bit of money while he was on break from school. But one night it was late, and Elizabeth was worried because Ted was supposed to be home from work already, and that's when her telephone rang. And Elizabeth answered, and she received the news that no parent wants to hear. On Ted's drive home from work, a car was coming from the other way, crossed the median, and hit Ted head-on. The driver of the other car was named Tommy Piggage, who had been to a party where he had had too much to drink. Friends had told him not to drive, but Tommy didn't listen, and so he blacked out, and he never even saw Ted Morris's car coming down from the other side of the road. And Ted died the next morning, on Christmas Eve morning, and Tommy's blood alcohol level was about three times the legal limit. About a month later, Tommy Piggage's trial began, and Frank and Elizabeth Morris were enraged when Tommy pleaded innocent. And after several repeated delays, almost 2 years later, the trial came to an end when Tommy Piggage reached a plea deal that allowed him to be freed immediately on probation. And so Tommy was free, but Frank and Elizabeth Morris were not. Elizabeth said she especially began to have revenge fantasies where she would fantasize and she would dream about killing Tommy Piggage. But Elizabeth soon began to have another problem because she was a recipient of God's grace. She was a follower of Jesus. And Elizabeth slowly came to the realization that holding this horrible grudge against the man who had killed her son, well, she couldn't continue to be a Christian while holding that grudge. And so for months and months and months, Elizabeth talked things out with God, and she soon realized that her heavenly father also had an innocent son who was killed. And she knew she had to release the grudge and forgive Tommy Piggage. And so she met with Tommy. She said she wanted to help him. She learned that Tommy came from a broken home where alcoholism was prevalent, and he needed a lot of help. But it wasn't long after that initial meeting that Tommy got drunk again, and he violated his parole agreement, and he was sentenced to 3 months in prison. But Elizabeth Morris continued to meet with Tommy, and when his sentence was over, both Frank and Elizabeth regularly met with Tommy, and they eventually built a relationship with him. They began to talk about their faith in Jesus with him, and one night the Morrises drove to their church where Frank Morris baptized his son's killer. Now, all of that happened right here in Kentucky, Hopkinsville, Kentucky, in the year 1985, and it's an incredible but a true and an amazing story of forgiveness and reconciliation. But the question I have today is, will that happen again? Is there a story of forgiveness and reconciliation that needs to unfold in your life? Is there an enemy that you need to forgive? Is there a hurt that you have inflicted and you need to make amends? Is there somebody in your life that you know is right now holding a grudge and it's eating them alive, it's hindering their faith, and you need to just sit down and talk with them about it and encourage them to begin the process of forgiveness and reconciliation? I'm going to guess that there are a lot of yeses to those questions. And so that's why I'm beginning today this 3-week study that I'm calling The Grudge. And we're going to study one of the shortest books in the Bible, the New Testament book of Philemon. And we're studying this book, which is actually a letter, because the theme of Philemon's one chapter is the grudge. And there are three characters in this letter, and each of the three characters represents a specific viewpoint about this grudge, and we're going to look at each of the three viewpoints in this series. Now, the first viewpoint is that of the one who is causing the grudge, and the character that's associated with causing the grudge is a man named Onesimus. Onesimus. Onesimus is a slave, and he has done something to cause a grudge with his master. Now, it's not specifically 100% spelled out in this letter, but it seems that Onesimus has stolen something or stolen some things from his master, things that were of value to him. So Onesimus is causing the grudge. His master is the second character, and his name is Philemon. And Philemon is a well-to-do Roman citizen who lives in a town called Colossae. Paul had written a letter to the church in Colossae called Colossians. But Philemon is a well-to-do Roman citizen who lives in Colossae, and Philemon is a strong man of faith who actually has a church that meets in his home. And like a lot of upper-class Romans in that era, he has slaves who are working for him. Now people hear that and they immediately think of people being forced into slavery against their will. Now that happens some in Bible times, but most slavery in the Bible is people who sold themselves into slavery in order to pay a debt or in order to avoid going to prison, for example. They would choose slavery over jail time, and then they could regain their freedom after they completely repaid their debt or if they were redeemed by a relative. But Philemon has this slave named Onesimus, and Onesimus has evidently stolen something from him, and so Onesimus has caused the grudge, and Philemon is holding the grudge. Onesimus is causing the grudge, Philemon is holding the grudge. And that leads us to the third character, the man in the middle, and that is the Apostle Paul. And the grudge viewpoint that Paul represents is that he is erasing the grudge, or at least he's trying to erase the grudge. Paul had become friends with Philemon, likely on one of his missionary journeys that took him through the city of Ephesus. And Philemon had become a Christian, and he's now a church leader in Colossae. But Paul is also friends with Onesimus. Because after Onesimus had fled Philemon, he ended up meeting with Paul at some point. Paul is in prison, and in that time, Onesimus became a Christian too, in addition to becoming a very valuable assistant to Paul. Look at what Paul says about Onesimus in verses 10 and 11 of Philemon chapter 1. Paul says to Philemon, "I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he's become useful to both you and me." This is a play on words that Paul says useless and useful, because the name Onesimus literally means useful. And so Paul finds himself friends of the man who's causing the grudge and friends of the man who's holding the grudge. And so Paul is going to stay in the middle, and he is going to assume the role of mediator. He is going to give erasing the grudge a go. And so the way he does that is he sends Onesimus back to Colossae to Philemon. And he sends with him this letter that today is our book of Philemon, this very personal letter that Paul writes to Philemon on behalf of Onesimus. And in this letter, Paul is going to plead with Philemon to forgive Onesimus because they are brothers in Christ now. He's going to urge him to drop this grudge. And really, every grudge that's ever held, every grudge that will be held, is going to have these three viewpoints, these three aspects. There's going to be a grudge causer, a grudge holder, and a grudge eraser. And truth be told, we are going to find ourselves in each of the three positions. And so we're going to look at each of these three viewpoints in the next 3 weeks and try to figure out how we can eliminate these grudges from our lives. And while there are three aspects or three viewpoints of the grudge, we're going to see that in each instance, regardless of the viewpoint you're in, there are two ingredients of getting rid of the grudge. And those two ingredients are grace and reconciliation. And so in each week, in each viewpoint of the grudge, we're going to see that each person involved in the grudge needs to do their part in bringing about grace and reconciliation. Now I say each person involved in the grudge needs to do their part in bringing about grace and reconciliation. Do your part. Whatever role you're playing in the grudge, play your part. Because you will have to answer for the part that you play, not for the part that somebody else plays. So if you're the one causing the grudge, you do your part to bring about grace and reconciliation. If you're the one who's holding the grudge, you do your part in bringing about grace and reconciliation. If you're trying to help someone erase a grudge, you do your part in bringing about grace and reconciliation. Don't try to do somebody else's part, is what I'm saying. You might have caused the grudge, for example, and you do your part, but the person holding the grudge still doesn't want to talk to you. They don't want to have anything to do with you. Doesn't matter. That's on them. You do your part to bring about grace and reconciliation. Or maybe you're the one holding the grudge, and you try to make amends with the person who hurt you, you try to forgive them, but guess what? They don't think they did anything to hurt you. They don't think they did anything that needs forgiving. They're offended that you're forgiving them because they don't think they've wronged you in the first place. Okay. You do your part to bring about grace and reconciliation. And so look, our focus in this study is going to be on this book of Philemon, but there's a corresponding verse, this corresponding theme verse that we're going to look at throughout this study, and it comes from Romans chapter 12, verse 18, where Paul says there, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. As far as it depends on you. Those are the key words. You do your part in living at peace with people. You can't control how other people handle a grudge. You can control, you will have to answer for how you handle a grudge. So whatever role you play in the grudge, you do your part in living at peace with everyone. Quick sidetrack. As most of you know, right now, our country is in shambles. I mean, it's bad. There have been darker days, I'm sure, but these last 3 months or so, with the coronavirus, first of all, and then we've got racial issues and rioting, looting, and racism has reared its ugly head again, for the most part, the year 2020 has been a big doo-doo sandwich for the United States of America. I get really frustrated with a lot of this stuff. I know I'm not alone because I've talked to you. I watch the news and I read social media. I see the footage of people looting and rioting, and I see people on the left side of the political aisle that drive me crazy, and people on the right side of the political aisle that drive me crazy. And I just have to think that you share a lot of those frustrations. But the tendency that I have, and I know that I can't be alone here, the tendency that I have is that I point to all these other people in society and I say, if you all would do this, things would be better. And I want to yell and I want to scream and I want to post things on social media. I want to get my two cents in and say, you all need to do this so our problems need to be fixed. It's like that guy who went to the doctor because he had a serious problem and he said, Doc, I hurt all over. He said, if I press my finger to my arm, it hurts. If I press my finger to my side, it hurts. If I press my finger to my neck, it hurts. If I press my finger to my knee or to my leg, it really hurts. And the doctor said, well, we need to take some x-rays. Doctor came back and he said, well, sir, you got a problem. We're going to have to operate. He said, you got a broken finger. And what we tend to do, what I tend to do at least, is I want to point a finger at all these other people and all these other groups, and I want to blame them for our problems. But how often do I point a finger at me? How often do I point a finger at me and ask, Evan, are you doing your part to live at peace with everybody? That's what I've been challenged with in these last few weeks. Because I have pointed the finger and pointed the finger, and I have blamed and griped, and I've offered my two cents. And here in these last few weeks, these words from Romans chapter 12, verse 18 just will not leave my brain. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everybody. In fact, just to be candid, as I was in writing this part of the message, I opened up my Facebook app and sent a message, Facebook message, to three friends of mine from Toledo, Ohio, that I went to college with, three black guys, and we always got along really well. We hung out a lot together. And I just sent them all three a message and said, guys, I want you to know that I really value our friendship. We've stayed in touch over the years. And I told them how much I appreciated them, and I hope that they appreciated me. And I told them, I said, I'm sorry that you've had to face some things because of the color of your skin that I have. Because I was with them at times when they faced things because of the color of their skin. And I just said, I love you guys, and I just want you to know that you can depend on me. And I sent the same message to a couple of other friends who don't even share my faith. And I said the same thing to them. And I just said, I want you guys to know you got a friend in me and I care about you. I've done the same thing with police officers. You work a really hard job for not enough money to keep us safe and secure. And even though they've sent me to traffic school half a dozen times over the years, I just want to let them know that I appreciate their service and their sacrifice. And I've got a long way to go, but as far as it depends on me, I need to be living at peace with everybody. And I would challenge you to do the same thing. And then as I was thinking about that, there was this other verse that popped in my head that I've heard some people talking about. It's where God talks about how you heal a nation. God in the Old Testament talks about how he is going to heal a people, a country that has gone wayward. Here's what God says. Here's how healing comes about in 2 Chronicles 7:14. God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. If what people? If my people. Too. Just this morning, out here talking to Jim White, and a visitor came in, and he made a very ugly racial comment just an hour and a half ago. Get us a visitor. I came in here, Jim said, you're going to ask him to leave. And I probably should have. But I knew this part of the sermon was going to be it today. So I just came in and said, I didn't appreciate your comment. He asked what comment, I specified it. If my people, who are called by my name, my people will humble themselves. My people will pray. My people will seek my face. My people, God says, will turn from their wicked ways. Then what? I'll hear. If my people, then I'll hear from heaven and I'll forgive their sin and I'll heal their land. If my people, as far as it depends on you. Those are two very personal challenges to followers of Christ. And so let's just decide, as God's people, let's just decide, as far as it depends on you and me, we're going to live at peace instead of pointing fingers of blame. That's hard, but let's strive. Back on track. Starting with Onesimus today. Onesimus is the one who's causing the grudge. And as I mentioned earlier, Onesimus had evidently stolen something from Philemon and then he ran away. It appears that he robbed his master and made a beeline out of town, is what it appears to be. At some point then Onesimus finds his way to Rome where Paul's in prison and he ends up meeting with Paul. We don't know when that happened. We don't know how it happened. But anybody who was ever around Paul had one of two reactions to the man. They either hated his guts because he wouldn't shut up about Jesus, or they became Christians because he wouldn't shut up about Jesus. Those were the two reactions Paul had to people. In the case of Onesimus, the latter proved to be true. Onesimus spends some time with Paul, and he becomes a Christian. Now, that's a wonderful thing. When a person decides to turn their life over to Jesus, because that person is then saved by the grace that only Jesus provides. But the thing is, when you accept Jesus as your Savior, you're not only accepting Him as your Savior, you're accepting Him as your Lord. So He saves you, but He tells you how to live. And as Lord, Jesus is pretty clear that if you take something that doesn't belong to you, then you have stolen it. And something that a follower of his will not do. And so Onesimus has received Jesus as his Savior, meaning he has been forgiven of his theft, but he's also accepted him as Lord, meaning he needs to make things right. He needs to do his part to bring about grace and restoration. Let's just say, for example, that Onesimus had stolen Philemon's Rolex and some cash that he had in a safe. We don't know what happened. Let's just pretend that Onesimus had stolen a Rolex from Philemon and some cash. Okay? What's the Christ-like thing to do if he's still in possession of these things? Return them. Return the Rolex, return the cash. If he doesn't have these things, maybe he's pawned off the Rolex and he's blown all the cash. What's the right thing to do as a follower of Jesus? Pay back the amount that you have stolen. Either way, it's on him to make restitution for what he's done to Philemon, being a follower of Jesus. But here is another problem with that. If Onesimus goes back to Philemon and returns what he has stolen, or if he pays back the amount of what he has stolen, he is facing some big-time punishment. Because the law of the Roman Empire in that time gave Philemon the legal authority to sentence Onesimus to execution. Or, if he didn't want to do that, Philemon could take Onesimus and have him branded on the forehead. They would take a hot iron and brand the letter F on the person's forehead, marking him as a fugitive for life. Well, even though the right thing to do could mean some pretty severe punishment, Onesimus has decided, look, I've accepted Jesus as my Savior and my Lord. I got to make this right. I've got to do, as far as it depends on me, what's right to live at peace with Philemon. And Paul was encouraging him and urging him to do this. And so Onesimus makes his way back to Philemon. He's carrying, literally, this letter that Paul has written to Philemon. And what happens beyond that is up to Philemon. But Onesimus has done his part as the causer of the grudge to bring about grace and reconciliation. And as the one who's guilty of causing the grudge, he does the two things that you have to do to bring about grace and reconciliation. If you have caused the grudge, there are two things you have to do to bring about grace and reconciliation. Those two things are confession and repentance. Confession and repentance. If you and I are guilty of causing the grudge, it is required of us to confess what we've done and to repent of that. That's the only way we can bring about grace and restoration, grace and reconciliation. But here's the thing about confession. We're not very good at it. And I don't know what it is, but voluntary confession seems, it seems like self-sabotage, right? When you voluntarily confess something. It's like if you're driving down the interstate and you're going 80 miles an hour in a 65 mile an hour zone, and you look and you see you're going 80 and you slow down, but then the next day you see a police officer and you go up to him and you say, you know, I need to confess something. Yesterday I was speeding. I was going 80 in a 65 zone. I just feel like you need to know that. We're not going to do that, right? We're not going to do that. If he pulls us over in the moment, we're going to apologize and say we're sorry, but we're not going to voluntarily confess. We have this tendency, rather than confess sin, to try to cover it up. And we'll try to cover it up, for example, by minimizing the sin that we've done. We treat it like it's not that big of a deal. And this is really kind of a popular thing for us to do in church, because we come up with this imaginary sin scale that's not found anywhere in the Bible, but we kind of know where we are on the sin scale, and we compare our sins to other people who seem to be doing a little worse than we are, and as long as we compare ourselves to them, then our sins don't seem like that big of a deal. They don't really need to be confessed or dealt with, so we minimize it by coming up with this sin scale. Another way we try to cover up our sin is we confess part of the way. Like, we'll confess a little bit of it. It's where we confess something, but we just give a fraction of what we are confessing. There's a lot more that could be said and should be said, but we don't say it. And the reason we do that is because of pride, trying to save face, trying to do damage control by just partially confessing something. I was reading this study a while back, and the study was entitled, I Cheated, But Only a Little. It reminded me of school, but I cheated, but only a little. And in this study, it involved over 4,000 people, and researchers found that people who partially confessed felt worse than people who didn't confess at all. And the psychiatrist who led this study said that confessing to only part of one's transgressions is attractive to a lot of people because they expect the partial confession to be more guilt-relieving than not confessing at all. But he said our findings show the exact opposite. People who partially admit what they did wrong feel guiltier because they don't take complete responsibility for their behaviors. In other words, they feel guilty about what they did, and they feel guilty about not confessing everything that they did. And it just kind of starts to pile on. And the Harvard Business Review summarized the research this way. It said confession is a powerful way to relieve guilt, but it only works if you tell the whole truth. But that's hard for us because of pride. We don't mind uncovering a little, but we don't want to come all the way clean. And yet we read these words in 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. John said, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But he said, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Confession means you come clean 100%. If we don't, Scripture says, truth is not in us. And maybe some of you are living with sin right now. That a year ago or 5 years ago, you felt broken over, there were tears involved, but you never confessed it. You never acknowledged it, drug it out in the open. And what it's done is it's created a wedge in a relationship, and that wedge is always going to be there so long as the confession stays inside you. So long as you be quiet, that wedge will always be there. And so confession is essential. If you're causing a grudge, or if you have caused a grudge, confession is essential for grace and reconciliation to happen. But so is repentance. Now, repentance is usually a word, I don't know about you, but the only time I ever hear the word repent is in church, or in a Bible study setting of some kind. A Sunday school teacher once asked her class what the word repentance means, and a little boy raised up his hand and he said, it's being sorry for your sins. Then a little girl raised up her hand and she said, no, repentance is being sorry enough for your sins to quit. And she's right. I've shared with you before, the word repentance is a combination of two Greek words. It's the word metanoia. The word meta means change, and the word noia means the mind. And so repentance literally means you change your mind. It means you were once selfish with your money, but now you're very generous with it. You used to sleep around, but now you live with purity. You used to be an addict, but now you're striving to be clean. It means you change directions. You turn around. You've been walking away from God's will, but now you're going to walk toward it. You turn away from sin, and you strive to live the life that God calls you to live. But again, that's not easy to do. Repentance is hard. And most of the times, I think it's incredibly difficult to do. I heard about a woman who bought a shirt for her husband and had a little tag on it that said, shrink resistant. And she asked the clerk, she said, what's that mean, shrink resistant? And the clerk said, well, it will shrink, but it doesn't want to. Not exactly what it means there. But the thing is, when you become a Christian, you're still going to sin. But repentance means you don't want to. Your mind and your attitude have changed. Genuine repentance means you confess your sin, you feel remorse for your sin, but then you repent. It's not enough to just cry. It's not enough to just come clean and confess. You have to take that extra step of repenting. You have to change your behavior and lifestyle. Peter Marshall, former chaplain of the United States Senate, once prayed this prayer. He prayed, Lord, we thank you that we can come to you just as we are, but help us that we dare not leave the way we came. As far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And if you have caused a grudge or if you are causing a grudge, confession and repentance are requirements for grace and reconciliation. So maybe this week, maybe today, you need to make a phone call to somebody. Today, you need to say to somebody, let's have lunch sometime this week and begin the process of confession and repentance. You do your part to live at peace with everyone. Doing your part to represent Jesus to a world that desperately, desperately needs him. Thank you, Father, for another day of life that you have given us. Thank you, Father, for your grace that is so amazing. It's so incredible. It's so freeing. But it also gives us responsibility to extend that same grace to other people. And Father, I pray that if there is somebody that we need to extend grace to, that we would begin that process. But Father, if like Onesimus, we have caused grace to be needed, help us to do our part to live at peace with everyone. Help us, Father, as your people, called by your name, to humble ourselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways. Help us to do those things as your people, to not point fingers of blame, to not criticize from the sidelines, to not get worked up and heated, to not throw fuel on fire. Help us, Father, as far as it depends on us, to live at peace with you. We pray that your Spirit would fill us and enable us to do that, and that as your people here, we would be the best representation of your Son that we can be. We pray all these things in his name. Let's stand today and sing our song of invitation.
Thank you.
taking our communion now, and as we've done the last couple of weeks, just take it when you feel like you need to be taking it, and you know, his team will play silently. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for what these emblems represent that we are about to partake. You're the body and the blood of your Son, which was voluntarily laid down for us. Father, never let us forget or take for granted that incredible sacrifice. Help us today, Father, just to examine ourselves closely as we partake of these emblems. Help us to focus on Jesus and his sacrifice and what that means for us today. We thank you so much that Jesus, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame. And Father, we can never repay you for that. But Father, I pray that our lives would be lived with an attitude of gratitude for that. Thank you so much for all that you do for us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand.
Thank you.
day.